Well, let's ask. We have here with us Congressman Tañada of the prosecution and Attorney Karen Jimeno. Why don't we ask them, Tony? I'm going to ask you, Erin. When are we going to finish this, at least on your side? Are we really going to finish this by March?
Well, we have a self-imposed deadline, and we'd like to finish presentation of prosecution's evidence before we go on congressional break. Our congressional break starts on March 23, so around that week, we should be ending our presentation of evidence. So whether we complete all 8 articles or we drop a few, I think we're headed for that direction.
Okay, but as a congressman lawyer, you know that as a prosecution, you do have control of certain things. Are you doing certain things now to hasten the process, such as whittling down the number of witnesses, whittling down the number of documents that you're going to present?
Yes, that is true, Adele, especially with the fact that the Senate Impeachment Tribunal denied our request to issue subpoenas for the Supreme Court justices. So right now, the different teams that would be affected by such a subpoena are now re-strategizing and limiting their presentation of evidence to what we can actually present at the impeachment tribunal. Those that would be affected by the denial would be, of course, Article 3 and Article 7. So with that, they started to compress the presentation of evidence. That the way that we see it, maybe we'd be able to complete Article 3 by Wednesday and proceed to Article 7 by Thursday.
And finish all the presentation by March 12? Is that the deadline?
More or less, that's the way we're looking at.
Okay. Okay, Karen, I want to ask you. Justice Cuevas said that all you need are 5 trial dates. Is that correct? You stick by that, that all you need are 5 session dates, trial dates in which to finish your presentation of evidence?
Yes, this is barring any other complications or mm-hmm. side issues, such as, for instance, what happened to the prosecution with the bank documents. But okay. just based on the evidence that we prepared, based so far on what the prosecution has prepared mm-hmm. and our reading of the impeachment complaint, then we need 5 days.
Okay, let's move on to another topic, Karen. You guys are in hot water mm-hmm. for that Sunday press con. Your thoughts on that, and do you believe that you've satisfactorily explained why you should not be held in contempt?
Well, some key points. This was outside of the impeachment court. It did not touch on any of the merits of the case, and the statements were not against any of the senator judges. It was actually, if you hear the press statement, it was addressed to Malacañang and to the president to tell them to stop interfering with the impeachment proceedings. And actually, the message was that we believed in the independence of the Senate impeachment court.
Okay.
So I think it was held in good faith, and it was more to protect the continuing independence of the impeachment court.
As in a related question, how is the independence of this court affected in your mind mm-hmm. as a member of the defense on the basis of the statements, the continuing statements from President Aquino in regard the case and in regard the guilt of Chief Justice Corona?
Well, I think in terms of the senator judges sitting in the impeachment court, I don't think it affects their independence, because mm-hmm. I believe that when they took that oath that they would render impartial justice, they would stand up to continue upholding that obligation. I think the concern more is on the trial by publicity, since okay. everyone concedes that there's a trial going on in public, and the problem is if the statements of the president would influence the minds of the citizens or the public in terms of the guilt of Chief Justice Corona, because we're still early on in the trial, the mm-hmm. defense has not yet presented their evidence, and to give statements as if he were already convicted, as if he were already guilty, it might give the accused here, it might affect him negatively, it might not give him his day in court.
Okay, Tonya, as a last question to Congressman Erin, what are your thoughts on the president's, he's also your party mate, your thoughts on his continuing attacks on the Chief Justice, and has anyone from your party perhaps cautioned him and told him, you know, let us take care of the prosecution of this case?
Well, as a citizen of the country, I think everyone has a right to express his opinion, including the Chief Justice mm-hmm. of the Supreme Court, as long as they stick to the facts of the case and do not swerve to other immaterial issues, then I think everyone has a right to say their piece. So it is within the right of the president to say what he wants to say. It is of no question that he has been very vocal with regard to his statements on the Chief Justice as early as December of last year. So there's really nothing new with what the president's saying.
Okay, Tony, maybe you have some questions for Erin or Karen?
Yeah, good afternoon, Congressman Erin and Attorney Karen Jimeno. First of all, on a lighter note to Attorney Karen, congratulations for being one of the three beauteous women selected by ABS-CBN News Online. Uh-uh. Okay. Have you read that article?
No, not yet. I haven't seen it. Uh-huh.
And nobody has even greeted you by text or email to say that you were among the three women cited as the head turners, so to speak, at the Senate impeachment trial.
No, I haven't seen that article. I haven't heard that as well. Someone mentioned to me today about women lawyers or the women in the impeachment. So I said, oh, so I suppose Congresswoman Cajabagao is also there, but I guess this is a different.
Yes. Beauty indeed is in the eye of the beholder. So, Attorney yes. Karen Jimeno, that's. I think it was just a good respite from all the tension generated by the Senate impeachment trial. But let me ask both of you, Attorney Karen and Congressman Erin, the Supreme Court still has, of course, to decide on the pending motion for injunction, no, on the impeachment trial, and that motion, of course, was filed by the defense for Chief Justice Corona. What's going to happen, Congressman Erin, if in fact the Supreme Court does decide that the trial should stop? In your view, what would be the effect?
Well, of course, it will make the Senate Impeachment Tribunal decide whether they would comply with the decision of the Supreme Court or not. Right now, Tony, I think what the Supreme Court had done was ask the Senate Impeachment Tribunal to comment within a certain period of days.
10 days, right.
Yes, with regard to the petition filed by Chief Justice Corona. So there will be an exchange of pleadings in the meantime before the Supreme Court decides on the issue.
Okay. So if ever the Supreme Court does decide to stop the trial, you feel that that would be acceptable. That would be something that the prosecution can live with, that the public itself can accept.
Let's put it this way, Tony. The decision will be made by the Senate Impeachment Tribunal. If they decide to proceed despite the temporary restraining order issued by the Supreme Court. Remember, there were statements made by Senate President Enrile, Senator Miriam Santiago, saying that the impeachment court cannot be stopped with regard to the trial of the case. And if they decide to continue, we will continue. If the impeachment tribunal says we will stop, then we have no choice but to stop.
Mm-hmm. And for Attorney Karen Jimeno, when people feel that the process is being hampered, and if the Supreme Court itself would say to put a stop to the trial, that they feel that, again, the Chief Justice has not proven his innocence, but has only successfully used the Supreme Court to cover up for some of his alleged misdeeds.
Well, I think the issue here would be how to educate the public on the grounds of why the preliminary injunction would be granted. Because if you look at that petition, the basis for asking for that preliminary injunction is because of the question of the validity of the complaint itself. And based on our jurisprudence and previous court decisions, any invalid complaint leads to invalid proceedings, which means that everything that proceeds therefrom is a complete nullity. So then that would only be consistent in accordance with law. But then, of course, we can't help the public from perceiving this as a way for the Chief Justice to get out of mere technicality. But then this really goes into the substantial rights of the accused. If you have an invalid complaint, then it would also be against his constitutional rights to due process to be convicted based on an invalid complaint. And I think in this case, what the prosecution can do is to to revise their complaint to make it to a valid complaint and then file that impeachment case again.
Mm-hmm. All right.